Let's do it. Come on.
Hi. I have a question. Hi. Can you come here for a second, sir? Thank you. Hello, chapel people, and welcome to Almost Chapel. You there in the back, get off your phone. I'm done. You're just like texting away, right? Your little cellular device. Oh no! Ah! Somebody call an ambulance!
Where did you even get those?
I have delimbed the Kono. I am now part Brian. All right.
It takes me a second to, so there's like five words in my title, which is complicated. Okay, my name is Susan. There's no real reason why it's like two C's. In first grade, my elementary school teacher started calling me CC, and then it just kind of stuck. I'm afraid of birds. My name is CC Said. I am the post-undergraduate outreach ministry intern at Spring Arbor University. I work with Brian Kono, and what we do is help connect students to churches, ministry opportunities, and volunteer opportunities in and off campus. I plan spring break trips, so be looking out for that kind of stuff because it's going to be coming out really soon. So as some of you may know, Brian Kono is pushing out this thing called Vibrant Christianity. There are three aspects: knowing, growing, and going. I'm involved with the going aspect of Vibrant Christianity through helping students go out into the community and going out to serve on spring break trips.
Oh, shoot. Clap on. Illuminate is this Friday night at 9:30 to 1 a.m. It's a night of worship, testimony, and prayer. There's an anti-human trafficking conference on October 13th. Go to sauseekjustice.com for more details or email Jeremy Norwood.
Ice cream?
Ice cream?
Ice cream!
Aw, no ice cream.
I didn't find any ice cream in the studio, but at 8 o'clock this Friday night, there will be Cold Stone Night, which is free ice cream for everyone. It's being served by the women's basketball team, and it's being put on by the SGA.
My hair's messed up now. I can fix it. Watch this. Boom. Fix. And now it's time for some All-American announcements. Baseball night is this Sunday at 7 p.m. in the Cougar Den. And also, the voting deadline is coming up. All-American duty. So, get registered to vote. Yeet America.
Hey! You there in the back. I see you still on your phone. I'm about to lose my hair. Time to go to chapel. Oh!
So if he is a part of me, am I a part of him? I'm a little bit frightened. Well, hope you had a great weekend this weekend with all the homecoming activities. I'm exhausted. I'm sure you are too. But now we turn the corner and I kind of look at homecoming as the point at which now it's time to think about all of the assignments that you've been putting off. And it's really time to buckle down, because if you don't get buckled in now, then you're going to be struggling the rest of the semester. But don't forget that we do have a lot of other activities going on. Homecoming doesn't end the activities. So check out the app. There's an activity coming this Saturday that isn't on the app that I just want to highlight. Some more details will be coming. In honor of Hispanic Heritage Month, from September 15th to October 15th, OIR is hosting a number of events, and this Saturday they're putting on La Feria, which is a festival, a fair. And so that's going to be around the oak tree. They're going to have some Mexican food and activities, so join them from 1 to 3 this Saturday around the oak tree. This morning, we have the privilege of hearing from Dr. Carlos Campo. Dr. Campo is the president of Ashland University. He also serves as the chair of the Hispanic Education Alliance of the National Hispanic Christian Leadership Conference. He has a PhD in English and an emphasis in drama. And had I known that before he came, I think I would have asked him to like pull a Paul Patton and do a performance monologue or something for us. You think he could just pull one out of his pocket? Right now, he is serving, as I mentioned, at Ashland University. He graduated from University of Nevada in Las Vegas, and recently, he was given the Liberal Arts Alumnus of the Year Award, which is like the highest, most prestigious award that UNLV offers, and he received that just this last year. So we'd like to pray for him as he comes to share with us. Dr. Campo, if you'd come right down here. Students, let's stand together, gather around Dr. Campo. Let's pray for him, pray for our morning together. Jasmine Harper is going to close us in prayer. She is an SLL and elementary education major from Clare, Michigan. So let's lift our voices in prayer together.
I thank you that you are moving and that you know every single person in this room, Lord. I pray that in this moment we would remember to be still in your presence, Jesus. And we don't even deserve to be in your presence, but still you allow us to be. I thank you for Dr. Campo and his willingness to chair today, Jesus. And I pray that you would just use him for your glory and let us listen to everything he has to say today. We love you, Jesus. Amen.
Let's draw our minds and our hearts together, focusing on the Lord, and use these words as a call to worship. Would you say these aloud with me? When I am afraid, I put my trust in you. In God, whose word I praise, in God I trust, I shall not.
crashes over me, for you are for us, you are not against us. Champion of heaven, you made a way for all to enter in.
Power, yours is the glory forever. Amen. Yours
the kingdom. Yours is the power. Yours is the glory forever. Amen. Let heaven come. Let heaven come. Let heaven come. Let heaven
You're beautiful. Jesus, thank you for this time to worship you. God, thank you that this time doesn't stop when we leave this place. Jesus, I pray for our hearts this morning. God, would you turn our eyes to you? Lord, I pray that we would have hearts on fire to see your kingdom come here, hearts on fire to know you. Jesus, prepare our hearts for this message this morning. God, I pray that this would be a continuation of the worship that we have been doing already this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. May the worship continue, because the Spirit within us is always crying out, Abba, Father, always. So it's only the flesh that pushes it down. So if you cry out, Abba, worship breaks out. That sounds good. What a blessing to be with you. I'm going to be talking about identity today. When I first got on this campus this morning, a little bit lost, trying to find my way, went to the Welcome Center, walked in, and was not welcomed. Initially, it wasn't their fault. It's my fault. You know, I'm overdressed. You walk in, you look lost. People looked up. Do you need help? Yes. And who came to my aid? Someone named Jonah. Come on. Someone named Jonah. And I am going to use Jonah as my passage. I hadn't planned that, but once he, I did. I had planned that. But the Lord knows. The Lord knows. Jonah and I, we just met, but you know what? The Lord just connected us. So we're connected now. Jonah and I are connected. Going to take it to Jonah. Truth is, if you want to be a creative writer, you want to look at Jonah. What? I'm not saying it's a work of fiction. No, no. It's one of my favorite books of the Bible. You know, people talk about why you believe in God. Look at your Bible. And I love Jonah because it's a mess. It's one of those books. If I were constructing a book to defend my faith, it would not be the first. Initially. You know, something about a guy swallowed in the belly, all this craziness. He's mad at God. Literally ends with him mad at God. We'll talk about that more in a minute. But the Lord sticks it in here and says, yes, I'm a complicated God. That's the God I worship. He's complicated. Not so simple. Story is not so simple. One of the reasons I love the fact that this book was not doffed. How do you translate doffed? Yes, he's spelling it out. Tossed out. Wasn't thrown out of the Bible. It's here. It's right here. If you are going to write a short story, this is the way, now, that's the first word, now. You know, the word we use now is so. I don't know when this started, maybe about 7, 8 years ago. So is the preface for everything else we say now. As an English teacher, I don't like it. Sorry. I don't like it. I'd prefer it with now. I don't like any better than so, but just one of my little pet peeves. Now, the word of the Lord came to Jonah saying, arise and go. To Nineveh, that great city. Call out against it. Their evil has come up before me. But Jonah rose. He's got that part right. To flee. Jonah rose to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa, found a ship, paid the fare, went down away from the presence of the Lord. Look what's happened in the first two sentences. Bang. God says, do it. Jonah says, no. And I'm just going to take a moment to say there's people here, because I've been there, running from God. Not going to take much time with this, but you know, if that's where you are, and I'm not coming down on you because I literally have lived in that place, but I'm going to say this to you. Don't spend another day there. October 1st, okay? October 1st, 2018, you and the Lord came to a new place together. Okay? Why not let it be today that you say, Lord, I'm not going to run anymore. That's it. I know I've been running from, because there's no peace without Jesus. There's no peace. If you're running from him, when will he give up on you? He is the God that leaves the 99. That's the God I know. He leaves the 99 to find the one. He walks outside of the presence of the congregation to find his son or his daughter. So if that's you, end it today, okay? Sorry, that's just for you. That's from the Lord to you, not from me. Away. But the Lord hurled a great wind upon the sea. Look, he's going to get away from God. No. You're on the boat getting away from the Lord. It's so funny to me because I'm old and I've seen my own life. I've been Jonah like 5,000 times. And there was a mighty tempest on the sea. The ship threatened to break up. The mariners were afraid. They cried out each to their God. It's what you do when crisis comes. You don't believe in God, but you believe in something, and when it comes, you're screaming. Ayúdame, Dios. Dios de mi vida santa. Help me, God, God of my holy life. And they hurled the cargo from the ship. That's what you do too when crisis comes. What do I need? What do I don't need? You think you need this? Watch when crisis comes. You'll see what you need. Here's what you need. Two things. Love God. Love your neighbor. That's it. Two things. Amen. Two things. Love God. Get that right. The cross is a daily reminder. Love God. It's literally in the shape. Love God. Love your neighbor. Get those two things straight. The hardest things that we can do. The hardest things we battle with as human beings. Get those two. That's what you need. Two things. Cargo. Get rid of the cargo. Where's Jonah? He'd gone down. Jonah had gone down to the inner part of the ship and laid down and was fast asleep. So many commentators write about this. Here, the pagan worshiping their own God, they have it right. They're doing the right kinds of things, praying in their own way. The man of God, asleep. Somnambulism, he's fast asleep. Many of us are literally sleepwalkers. We're somnambulists. We are walking without direction. Do you know I'm an English guy, so literature has animated my life. I think about Alice in Wonderland. That's us. Remember that great scene? Alice always running around looking for where to go. She encounters the Cheshire Cat and said, "Which road shall I take?" The cat smiling to himself. That's what cats do that think they know everything. And he says perfectly, logically, "Alice, where are you going?" And she said, "I have no idea." Then he says, "Then any road will do. Any road will get you to the place where you don't know. If you don't know where you're going, take any road, Alice." Somnambulist, many of us, sleepwalking through life. God, what's my purpose? Lord, I'm waiting for my direction. You've got it. I'm just not being fed in this university, in this church. Get a fork. God is alive. I'm not going to sleep. There's a storm. It's everywhere. It's all around. Are we going to let the world pray to their gods and we're going to sleep? Not going to happen. Wake up. The mariners, get him up. Love this. Captain came down and said to him, "What do you mean, you sleeper? Arise, call out to your God." And they said to one another, "Come, let's cast lots." Wish I had time for this. Been in the Bible a long time. Let's cast lots. And they fell to Jonah. Running, sleeping, far away in a ship. We're going to roll some dice, basically. And the lot falls to you. And they said, "Tell us, what is going on?" And he says, "Yeah, it's me. It's me. But when the crisis comes," what do they ask him? "What is your occupation? Where do you come from? What is your country? What people are you? From what people are you?" See, when crisis comes, people want to distill us. I'm going to talk about identity. Right here it is. Jonah, who are you? Wait a minute, who is this guy? I've been sleeping down here. Are you the cause of all of our troubles? And when crisis comes, people are going to say, "Who are you? Who are you? What are you all about? Where do you go to church?" Right? That's one of these things. What's your faith? Faith or no faith? All right, there you go. Here's an identity piece. Faith or no faith? Age, height, weight, serial number. See what I'm getting at? It's a distillation. We're going to take away this. We have touched the eternal, because Jonah's answer is unbelievable. He said to them, "I am a Hebrew," okay, so there's my people, "and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and dry land." See, the minute you identify with the God who is infinity, right? He literally speaks into being all things that are, and you are his child. So the world, here's one of the things I want you to take away. The world will try to distill your identity into five, six things. Tell me these five or six things, and I don't need to know one more thing about you, because I will tell you who you are. It's what the world wants to do. They want to tell you who you are and who you should be. They're going to distill the vast variety that God has put in you. Here's my mini drama. All right, here it is. Just for you, Brian. Just for you. Didn't prepare this. But here's what Juliet, a 13-year-old girl, said. Along those lines. Here's what Juliet said to someone she loved. "My bounty is as boundless as the sea, my love as deep. The more I give to thee, the more I have, for both are infinite." Think about that. Was she not a young girl who had touched God? Because none of us had the fullness of infinity within us without God. "My bounty is as boundless as the sea, my love as deep. The more I give to thee, the more I have." That's the God we serve. Are you Hispanic? Yes, I'm going to take you back to my third grade classroom. Are you with me? Third grade classroom. I mean, I'm going back. For me, that's a long time ago. My third grade classroom. Here's the ritual. Day after day, it's called roll. Roll call. Here come the names. Here it comes. C. Campo. Are you there? Carlos Campo. And she called my name, and I hear it. She may not have said it that way. She probably said Carlos Campo. Carlos Campo, are you here? And I want to say no. That the person you would associate with that name is not here, because that name is so particularly tied to the Latino community. Do you know how many times someone has said to me in my life, Carlos? You're Carlos? It's funny, because you don't look like a Carlos. You don't look like a Carlos. See, the identity thing, is that what I said I'd come speak about? It's as though they were walking around some picture in their wallet, you know? See, Carlos is supposed to look like this. Red cape, mustache, I don't know what it is. Probably not those things. But I remember being a third grader and thinking to myself, my father was born in Cuba. He blessed me with that name. It didn't feel like a blessing as a third grader. I wanted to be John or Bill, tell me, like for a day. Because I didn't have his beautiful dark skin that was the color of café con leche that he had every day of his life. I didn't have his facility with the language. Y por eso todos los días de mi vida soy hablando un poco como un acento como un anglo. Y también no tengo las palabras que él tenía. No tenía la palabra de alguien que nací en Cuba o un país de Latinoamérica. Sí, sí, es la verdad. Algunos de ustedes conocen mi lengua, no? So what I basically said was I didn't have the facility with language that my father did. So I sound like an Anglo when I speak Spanish. You're already translating for your friends, I know. I thank you. But instead, I fought, not only fought the language, I fought my identity, because I wanted to melt away from my culture and join the dominant culture. It was just a natural tendency. I wanted to belong. I'm a third grader. I just wanted to be a part of what they were a part of, and I didn't feel like a Carlos. I didn't look like a Carlos. I was disappointing them just with my looks. Hi, I'm Carlos. Funny, you don't look like a Carlos. Sorry. How else may I disappoint you in our third second of knowing one another? Come on. See? It seems so simple. Richard Rodriguez, a writer, a Latino writer, said, you know, sometimes Latinos take this the wrong way, perhaps. We take it like, well, wait a minute, Carlos, well, you're not from around here, are you? Right? Literally, in the town I live in, Ashland, Ohio, I think I'm the only Carlos. I think. I literally, in a way, it's kind of fun, because I can just say, it's Carlos, and they know it's me. 20,000 people. I literally believe, I think I'm the only person with that first name. Someone did tell me they named their dog Carlos. I don't know if it was in my honor or not, but but you know, so you're not from around here, and sometimes you hear that is, you're not from around here and you don't belong here. You know, one of our most influential alums at Ashland recently, when they heard that I was hired about 3 years ago, said, how could Ashland ever even hire someone named Carlos? That got back to me, and it hurt. It did. It hurt. But it hurt me for him more than me. It did. You know that phrase, you don't know me? It's so true. You don't. And I want us to push back against those who, like here with Jonah, where are you from? What are your people? What's going on here? Let me distill you down so we can figure out what's going on. But let me find out these six things and we'll know who you are. And when people say, what is he or she like? I want to say to them, find out for yourself. And don't limit it to 5 meetings, maybe not 50. You know, C.S. Lewis talked about this when he talked about friendship and losing a friend within a circle. Literally, that you're reflecting something about me that no one else can. I know myself more deeply, part of the body of Christ. We know one another more deeply in community. And the more complex, diverse is the term that's often used, that community is, the more we know one another in Christ. And we lose something when that community is not as diverse as it can be and should be. And folks, I want to add to diversity, diversity of thought and opinion, skin color, background, ethnicity, all those things are fine, but they're no guarantee. I, especially as a third grader, had no more affinity with the Latino culture than any Anglo. I mean, literally today, as you already heard, I will quote Shakespeare before Cervantes just because of my background and study. Some people say, well, you know, you began studying English to push back against those who listen to your father. And he said to me, my son, I can't believe it that you are an English professor because I cannot speak English. And my whole life I fight this language, and you now are a professor of English. I don't know what that means to be a doctor of English, but he cried. My father was there when I got my PhD, and he cried. But he understood something about the complexity of the world. He understood that for him, the language of power in America was English, and he wanted his son to learn it. I don't know if I learned English to push back on my Hispanic past. I never consciously thought that, but I'm glad that I have. It's part of who I am. People say, well, you're not Latino enough. I say, I'm sorry, this is who I am. I'm not going to be more Latino, less Latino because you think I should be, period. I'm going to try to fulfill what God's called me to every second of my life. That's what I'm going to try to do. That's what I'm going to try to do, whatever that is, on whatever scale and whatever spectrum, that's where I want to be. And I will tell you that someone who has been around education my whole life, I understand that's another question that's asked. Where did you go? What did you study? What is your degree? And folks, we put on these robes. Are you with me? Hold on now. I'm getting very personal with the academics in this group. We put on these robes. They're a reflection of dignity and heft, of title and power. You literally receive letters of acceptance. That's what they're called. What in the world is that? A letter of acceptance? I've been rejected. I've been accepted. Can you imagine? I'm going to tear open this letter. And literally, I hear people more thrilled about getting accepted into a college or university than getting accepted into the kingdom of God. Uh-oh. I just got personal. Sorry. I'm being frank. I know it's part of my business, but I think of parents who say, my daughter, who's been running from God, today came to know Jesus. And I'm going to get on the top of my roof and scream with joy because she is now tied to me eternally. And we will be together in heaven forever. I want to see more parents screaming about those things than my kid got into Harvard. And I get it, folks. But are you with me? See, there's a pecking order in life. And that's part of this identity thing. Smart, smarter, smartest. Right? Smartness, knowledge can be power. And if we don't use it for the right purposes, God help us. And here we are at a Christian institution. And the truth is, there was a scandal among evangelicals because we put erudition on the shelf. Wrong. Learning and knowledge and science and all of those things need to be at the forefront of our study. We led the way as people of God in the academy. Hear me. We led the way. We didn't see any conflict between faith and science. We saw no such thing as the secular and the sacred. We know it's all sacred unto the Lord. All of it. It's all yours, God. All of it sacred. All of it. And so I'm going to urge you as well, work harder. No one paid me to say this. Work harder. You think, I've got no more time. I can't even devote 5 more minutes to it. Yes, you can. Be a leader in your field. And be known as a Christian leader. You know what? Be known as a leader, and then people will come to know, and she's a person of faith. He's a person of faith. Lead with your mind and your heart. It's both and. God called us to love him with all of this, all of it. So work even harder. Let that PhD literally be a signal of, you know what, as God moves me up and higher, I'm going to get down lower. If I want to be first, I'm going to be last. And I do. I want to be first in my class. I want to be first. I want to be first in my class. Not for pride, for him. For him who's called me to that. He's called me to a higher place. Let's go to that higher place. I don't know what I'm so excited about. I love it. Well, we know what happens. I love this next scene. You know, these guys grab Jonah, you know, and like ready to throw him overboard. And they're like saying, sorry, God, that we don't know. You know, sorry, we don't really want to throw him overboard, but we really don't have a choice because we know that the minute we do, this is an ancient belief, right, that something has brought guilt and shame or trouble to the community and must be cast overboard. Ancient. It's in Romeo and Juliet, right? Literally, they had to die. The Montagues and the Capulets would have fought forever, but were it not for the sacrifice of those two lambs. Are you with me? Ancient. And yes, the Lord becomes the eternal scapegoat, but not here. It's Jonah. Toss him overboard, and once they do, their troubles are over, and in some ways, his just start. His just start. Gets swallowed in the belly of a whale. And you know what? Here's another one of those where people say, well, Carlos, you're an educator. Come on. There are acids in the stomach of fish. Maybe it wasn't a whale. Maybe it was a fish. He never could have survived that. All I want to tell you is this. Yeah, I know we can go on YouTube and there's some guy there who said he survived 3 days, and maybe he did, in the belly of a whale. So maybe it did occur and maybe it didn't. Here's the God I serve. He was born of a virgin. He's the God I serve. I'm not going to get so hung up on 3 days in the belly. Was it a miracle? Maybe. Was it real? Maybe. That's not where I'm getting hung up. Two places, love God, love my neighbor. I get hung up there all the time. That's where I'm getting hung up, those two places. Here he is in the belly of a whale. Chapter 2, can't read it right now, but if we don't spend time reading that chapter, we're missing out, because here is a prayer of thank you, God. 3 days. And yes, Jesus himself referred to Jonah, and he knew what it was to be 3 days. I'm not making it metaphorical, but he knew what it was. Jonah and Jesus parallel in many ways. Here he is, and the worship of chapter 2 is phenomenal. I'm not going there. I'm blowing right past the belly. I'm blowing right past the prayer. But I'll take you back sometime to that. It comes to him a second time. And the second time he arose and he did what he was supposed to do. And he preached the word of God. And that's still what we're called to do. And yes, I agree with you that particularly my generation may have missed it, because I think you earn the right to speak into someone's life about their faith. I think you have to earn that right. There are times when you haven't felt like you've earned the right, but God's calling you to say something, you got to do it, right? You know, sometimes it's the checkout line, sometimes it's the street corner. I'm not saying there's not a place for that. He did his thing, and God saw the way they turned, and yes, the God that I know relented. That's the Lord. He relented. He had mercy. That's the Lord. So last chapter should be pretty easy. They all lived happily ever after. Jonah initially rejected the call of God, answered the call, goes and preaches, they get saved, the Lord is happy, chapter 4. But it displeased Jonah exceedingly. What? What? It displeased Jonah exceedingly? How? How? What just happened? You're the prophet of God. People just got saved. What are you upset about? And he prayed to the Lord, that's a Shakespearean word. Oh, Lord, is this not what I said? Did I not tell you? See, did I say I've been Jonah 5,000 times? I hope you've never been Jonah. But this is it. God, I knew it. I knew this was going to happen. Didn't I tell you this was going to happen? This is not what I wanted to happen, Lord. Thy will be done. You just prayed the Our Father. You prayed the prayer the saints have been praying for 1,000 years, 2,000 years. Our Father, thy will be done. No, Lord. What did I do? I knew it. I knew it, he said. Look at these Ninevites. Oh, God, is that what I said when I was yet in my country? This is the English Standard Version I'm reading from. The NIV says, in my home. Other versions say, with my people. See? He's displaying the clanism that we are subject to. Let me say that again. Jonah is displaying the clanism that we are subject to. Did I say identity would be my subject today? My theme is identity. When I was with my people, mi gente, in my country, mi país, con mi gente, yo te digo, adios, yo sabía. See how angry I am, even in Spanish. That angry Jonah I'm doing here. I knew it, Lord. My people, my country, my home. What a dirty four-letter word that is. Your home. Where is your home? Look at me getting mad at you now. Home. It's on your birth certificate. Country of origin. You know what? It's probably illegal. Scratch it off. Scratch it off. You are not of this place. You are not from Michigan. I know. I'm from Ohio. I'm sorry. I know it. You're from Michigan. Some of this is right. Some of it is so wrong. Literally, The Feast of Tabernacles, called Sukkot or Sukkot, just ended literally yesterday. Did I say today's a new day? Yesterday, that festival ended for observant Jews. You know what that festival's about? It's literally where Jews take a structure. They build it with palm fronds and other kinds of things outside of their home as a reminder of how the Lord was with them during their 40 years of wandering. It's a reminder that this is not our home. It ended yesterday. It should be a daily reminder to us. Daily reminder. Your home, if you're building your home in this place, and that can mean here, Michigan, U.S., Earth, we're missing it, folks. Our home is in heaven. Our home is in heaven. That's our home. Love of the world is enmity with God. Isn't that what the word says? It's the toughest challenge of all. Prepare. It's right to prepare for your future and understand the important legacy that you have to your children and grandchildren and grandchildren's children, children. I said that with as much stentoriousness as I can muster. It's not enough to say that because some of that is right. Some of that is right, and some of it is so wrong. Every brick I put upon brick that is building something in this world is at some level missing the point. All the bricks are coming down, all of them. All of those will come down in time. You know, the truth is, when Jonah comes to the end of this book and God says, "Do you have any right to be angry?" You know what his answer is? Yeah. Yes, that's how he ends the book. Yes, I do. And God said, "How dare you? You had more compassion on a plant." Remember that? The plant grows up, and man, he likes the plant because it brings him shade. God help me. Everything I like and love on this earth, God, let me see it through the lens of your heart and your eyes. Everything, whatever it is, whatever plant it happens to be. Whatever food, whatever person, whatever brick, whatever plane or car. God, please, God, don't let me for a day's shade give up your gifts. A day's shade. And here he is, a day's worth of shade. Plant comes up, you fall in love, it goes down, you're sick. 5,000 times I've been Jonah in my life. That girl, Lord, how did you, why? God, Lord, that job. I remember 15, 20 years ago, got my PhD, I'm working 3 jobs, and I can't support my family. I can't make it. Got to go back to work. I went back to work and worked as a valet parker, parking cars at a hotel in Las Vegas. Had a PhD, and I thought to myself, this isn't right. You're literally the most overqualified human being on earth. This is my internal narrative. Most overqualified, yeah, I'm your PhD valet, have a nice day. No, have a grand day. It was the MGM Grand. Every single stinking time, I had to say, have a grand day. That got old about 4 times later. You're with me there. And I'm parking cars, and I'm grousing in the Lord. Come on, Lord, followed you my life. I went and got that PhD, and here I am, and they're telling me that I have no future in academia. 20 years ago, less, I'm parking cars. That's me. With a PhD. God help me. And I wish I could tell you that every day it got better. It didn't, but I'll tell you what the Lord spoke to me. And he said, this is your training ground for what's next. This is your job. It's not your home. Get over it. Get over it. I'm with you. Always. That attitude that you just had and way you handed that thing to that customer, that was wrong because it didn't reflect the highest and best in every regard, in every place. You reflect the highest and best, and let me handle the rest. I wish I could say I did it every day as well. I didn't, but I learned more about humility and leadership, parking cars, than I have as president of university. And I will tell you folks that now there is a space, more than one, on this campus with my name on it at Ashland. More than one space, got my name on it. See how I'm getting now? Got my name on it now. Carlos Campo, oye, ese nombre, that name that I hated, you know how many students in my classes, when I used to teach English after they got over the confusion. Carlos Campos, our English teacher. Anyway, when they got over that confusion, I saw so many brown and black faces out there, and they were Latinos. And I said, why? Why are you in my class? Why? I know it was in Las Vegas, a Latin town. But they said, I'm in your class because of your name. We saw Campo. And we thought maybe he knows something of our background, of our struggle, of our lives. Maybe there's a connection that we can make. Of course, I would say the connection that we're going to make is I will treat you with love and respect because of the God that I serve. No matter what you are, who you are, what your background, I will treat you with love and respect. It was her name. That name, now I see it on signs. Reserved for President Campo. And the Lord says to me, you love that? Wrap your identity up in that, and it's just as sinful. Just as sinful as when you wrapped up your identity in being a valet parker. Because my bounty is as boundless as the sea. My love is deep. The more I give to thee, the more I have. I was born in a manger. Think that's happenstance? I could have been born in the finest place in Jerusalem. I was born in a manger. So that people would never, ever associate what they do, who they are, their station in life with blessed of God. Ever. That was me. I could have been anywhere. I came from the backwater. He's a Nazarene. I spoke of Isaiah in the scroll, and people welcomed me, and then they said, well, wait a minute, isn't he Jesus? Joseph and Mary's son. I know his people. He can't be that. You see, that's the God we serve. Jonah, I'm you, and you're me. God, help me not to be Jonah today, to know that my home is in you. To know that whether my name's on a sign or I've got to park a car that's got somebody else's name on it doesn't matter because I'm a son of the living God. Peter said, you are living stones. Living stones, Peter said to us. Peter, that stone upon which God's going to found his church, that man of faith who became known as the traitor. A little girl pointed him and said, weren't you with him? Not me. Not me. And he lived with that for years and years and years. And God changed his heart and said, my identity is yours, living stones. I'm going to use that name again, living stones. That's me. There was a missionary working in Africa, teaching about Jesus for years. Told the kids, paint a picture. Never seen him. Paint a picture of Jesus. The kids in that missionary compound painted his picture, the missionary's picture. May our identity be found in him. I have been crucified with Christ. No longer I who live, but he who lives through me. That's what he's calling us to. Let's pray. Father, here we are, Latinos and Anglos, African Americans, tall, short, smart, not so smart. Father, all the ways the world wants to dilute and then distill, God, you're so much greater than all of that. Let us find our identity in you and not settle ever for anything less. God, change us. Let it happen today, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Join me in thanking Dr. Campo. If you'd like to take a minute just to pray with some of our prayer team this morning, just about maybe the identity issue or other things that are going on in your life, please feel free to do that. Come forward. Our team will be here. On Wednesday, hear this just real quick. On Wednesday, we're going to take a special time from 9:55 to just when chapel begins to pray for the peoples who have been affected by the natural disasters over the course of the last 2 months. India, Indonesia, the Carolinas. We'd love to pray for you if you know someone in those places. We'd like you to be a representative of the family members who have been affected. So that's 9:55 to 10:05 on Wednesday before chapel. If you want to come and join our prayer team, we'd love to have you. Again, thank you, Dr. Campo, for being with us today. You're dismissed.